One of the things I worry about, and I know many of you do too, is that our younger generation are being force-fed the idea in our public school systems, our colleges and our universities, that borders and American sovereignty are sinful, if not completely evil concepts. So I was encouraged and actually astounded to discover recently that there's a network of very young and patriotic podcasters and YouTube show hosts who have researched and read extensively on these issues and come down firmly in our camp. They often have thousands and even tens of thousands of active followers or subscribers. One of these incredibly bright young people is our next speaker, Nicholas J. Fuentes. Nick is a 19-year-old college student who hosts a program called America First on YouTube. Folks, you just have to watch some of these programs. One of his recent shows was entitled The DACA Demolition Debate. The title of Nick's talk today is Putting America First. So that's enough from me. Nick, you have the podium. Thank you.
Thank you, KC, for that warm introduction. I have to say before I get started, usually if I were in the audience and I see, you always have at these events, the young guy come up, the up-and-comer. Usually I'm a bit cynical about it. I'm cynical about young people who don't have experience, and certainly I'm no exception to that. So I submit to you my speech, my thoughts, with a little bit of humility, because I understand that I've shared the stage with people who are distinguished in their fields. They have expertise, they have experience, and I've graduated high school, so I don't know if I meet everybody there. But so I'm often asked, and I was asked a couple of weeks ago, I had a New York Times reporter doing a story about young people who are involved in the conservative movement. And I'm asked a lot, and I was asked about this reporter how I could be so young and I have far-right views on social issues, particularly immigration. She said that she expects that sort of opinion from a Pat Buchanan, a Sam Francis, sort of the Archie Bunker archetype. And we know who that is, the old crank who doesn't like people because they don't look like them. And I said, my generation, Generation Z, they're going through high school. These people are 17, 18, 19 years old. They're going into college, and they're coming out of college in a very broken country. They're going into college incurring thousands, tens of thousands of dollars, sometimes hundreds of thousands of dollars in student loan debt. They're coming out of college and there's no jobs because of downward pressure on wages from immigration, because immigrants, both high-skilled and low-skilled, have taken the jobs. Housing prices are through the roof. And I'm always astounded at the fact that if you look at young conservative organizations, there is not a single one that holds immigration as important or even an issue that they talk about. The main youth conservative organizations are Young Americans for Liberty, Turning Point USA, Young Americans for Freedom. And they care more about lowering taxes for multinational corporations. They care more about lowering regulations for the stock market. And it always bewilders me that young people who are being affected the most by social issues, the standard position is socially liberal, fiscally conservative. And it's a real problem. I think everyone needs to think about it, that not a single institution, not a single organization where they have massive infrastructure, massive mobilization, massive funding, not one of them is serious about immigration or even conservative as far as I'm concerned about immigration. And so I want to talk a little bit about my journey. I certainly was not big on the immigration as well. I was no exception to this standard. I came up in my intellectual development as a disciple of Milton Friedman, Thomas Sowell. We've all been there, the Ron Paul libertarian type of stuff. And I never really saw immigration as a major issue. It was always sort of an ancillary, something else that was going on. And I took the standard position. Illegal immigration is wrong. Everyone can pretty much wrap their heads around that. People shouldn't break the law. But legal immigration was basically fine, so long as people did the paperwork. And my mom always asked me, because I do America First, and it tends to be just about every day an hour-long rant about immigration. They say, why is that the only thing you're focused on? Why is that the only issue? And it's because there is no market share for that immigration issue for young people. And so I started out, like I said, the fiscal conservative, the Milton Friedman. The only thing that matters is the gross domestic product. And probably the first thing that brought the immigration issue to my attention was electoral politics. You know, I came around to this issue during the 2016 election with Donald Trump. And I wasn't wild about Trump. I was the Ted Cruz constitutionalist. But I saw that even if you had a guy like Ted Cruz in office in 2016, even if he gets elected in 2020, even if he has a Republican House and Senate, if the demographics don't change, if immigration policy doesn't change, Texas goes blue. Arizona goes blue. New Mexico goes blue. Georgia, Colorado, Nevada, every state in the union eventually goes blue. All you have to do is look at the statistics. I look at Pew Research in 2012, where the largest immigration group, and I think it's just about every state except for Hawaii, is Mexicans. That's the largest immigration group for every state in the union. And if you look at Hispanics as a group, regardless of the fact that they went 70% for Hillary Clinton, if you look at the actual data on what they believe, what their ideology is, what they're predisposed to, it's not a pretty picture for conservatives, for people that like economic liberty. And that's where I came from initially. And you look at Pew Research, for first-generation Hispanics in this country, legal immigrants, we're not talking about illegals, for first-generation Hispanics, 80%, more than 80% of Hispanics support big government. Now, for the public at large, that number is 46%. So you're talking about almost double, very close to double, for first-generation Hispanics that support big government, 80%. Second generation, not much better, 71%. Of second-generation Hispanic immigrants support big government. Third generation, it's 54%. So you're still talking about a major differential between the public at large, which is not a pretty picture either, by the way, on big government, and they're, by the third generation, still not assimilated, still not integrated into the American conception of limited government, small government, that any regular conservative can wrap their heads around that idea. So that was the first position that I came from, was electoral politics. You know, look, you don't have to agree with everything. You don't have to agree that, you know, maybe we need to cut immigration in half in the next 10 years with the RAISE Act. But you have to acknowledge at the very least that by 2024, Texas will turn blue. And Texas goes blue, Republicans will never control the White House or the Senate until the end of time. You will have Democratic control forever. And what do they do when they get in office? They legalize the between 11 and 30 million illegals that are here. That's another 30 million voters for the Democrats. They let open immigration continue, and Asians certainly have a predisposition to big government as well. And this continues forever. And there is no small government. There is never this make America great again. And that was really the first thing. That was the first red pill, so to speak. And then it was the economic reasons. As I went to college and I realized I was up in Boston University, it was costing students who were paying full boat for tuition upwards of $70,000 a year to attend school. And for a degree that at this point in time is probably as valuable as a high school diploma was 40 years ago. And they're sinking themselves sometimes $300,000 in debt for this degree. And I thought, you know, I'm sinking all this money. I have like a $49,000 scholarship, so it wasn't the end of the world for me. But I thought, I'm sinking all this money. And for what? To come out of school and be displaced by a high-skilled Indian immigrant who's probably here on some kind of visa, but that isn't talked about by the Republican establishment, by Young Americans for Liberty, by Young Americans for Freedom. Thank you. Yeah, I suppose it's sort of the Alex P. Keaton archetype I'm fulfilling here, but that's before my time. But so I really started to see the economics of it when I was in college, because I understood that when I came out in 4 or 5 years, depending on my grades, which were certainly not great, we didn't study immigration in school. But so I realized that when I was coming out of school in 4 or 5 years, I'm not going to be able to pay all this back, because you have immigrants coming into this country that, by the way, didn't pay into Social Security. Their parents weren't here building the railroads and building the factories. They just sort of washed up on the shores to take advantage of the fruits of the labors of our ancestors. So the economic was a big part of it too. And then finally, I think I started to move into a much more important, much more metaphysical territory on the immigration as a whole, which was the culture. And everything prior to that, every red pill before that, basically went away in terms of what really mattered. which is to say that even if I had a job when I got out of college, even if the Democrats weren't so bad, or maybe the Hispanics integrated and they voted, you know, 50% for Republicans, 50% for Democrats, I live in a small suburb in West Chicago. If I drive 15 minutes east down Ogden Avenue, I'm in Little Village, I'm in Pilsen, and every sign is in Spanish, and everyone speaks Spanish, and it's a small enclave, essentially, of Mexico, where there's drug cartels, there's violence, and I don't care what the GDP is, I don't care what the unemployment rate is, I don't care about any of the rest of that, if America isn't like America. And you'll notice, if you look on the program, my last name happens to be Fuentes, which is not an Anglo-Saxon name. But I look back at my ancestors, I'm a fourth generation Mexican, and my ancestors, not only did they come into the country when immigration was 86% European and the nation at large was 90% European, so there was assimilation, but my ancestors came here to escape Mexico, to get away from Mexico, not to pick it up, come across the border, and put it down 15 minutes east of my suburb. And so I realized that this was a totally different field, a totally different ideological frontier for the right wing that has yet been unexplored, that there's no money, that there's no infrastructure, that none of our young people are hearing about. Because you go from kindergarten to college and it's diversity training. It's telling everyone that we're all unique, we're all special, we're all egalitarian, we're all the same, and everything's fine. And I started to really pull apart the issues, not so much from these, the economic, the cultural, the electoral, but really get into the matter of justice, really get into the social contract, for example, which I noticed is the name of the publication for this organization, which is something very telling, which is to say that when our people came together to form this country in 1788, when the Constitution was ratified, we said that we would give the government certain responsibilities that we couldn't otherwise perform as individuals. We made a social contract. And the libertarian sort of sect that's taken over the Republican Party, that's dominated by individualists, they do not see the lineage of the people in this country, that we have parents, and their parents had parents, and so on and so on, that built everything that's here, that built this building, that built all the material that we have here, that built the social capital to make this country work. And so when we have a social contract, we don't have to justify ourselves by saying, well, illegals can't come here because it's against the law, but if they're legal, well, we just have to let them in. When we form a social contract with our government serves the people. Immigration policy, like any other policy, is constructed to serve our people. That is axiomatic. That America should come first in any calculation, in any evaluation of pros and cons of immigration policy. So often, beyond the electoral, beyond the economic, we look at what is best for the people coming here. We look at the plight of the poor Mexicans that just want to come here for an opportunity to live. We never look at the plight of Kate Steinle, who's gunned down by illegal immigrants. We never look at the plight of all our unemployed college kids who their jobs have been stolen by high and low skilled immigrants. And you can break down the numbers any way you want. You could get any econometrician from Stanford University to tell you that no, actually they're growing the economy and you can have it all ways. But in any evaluation, you have to make a choice. Who is the winner and who is the loser? And for 50 years since the 1965 Immigration Act, America has been the loser at the expense of immigration, both legal and illegal. And this is not just confined to the immigration issue in particular, it also has something to do with foreign policy. But you look at our foreign adventures overseas and you again have to ask, who does that benefit? When we go over into Iraq, or we go into Libya, or we go into Syria, or Yemen, or Iran, or Sudan, or Somalia, and we topple a government, we destroy society, not only is it bad for the people that are there, who, you know, you have children where their living rooms just get exploded because they want a pipeline to go through Syria, but on top of that, what happens to Europe? What happens to America in the wake of such humanitarian catastrophes? who ends up the sole responsibility for all of these displaced peoples in every humanitarian crisis? Who is expected to open our doors to the displaced Syrians, the displaced Iraqis and Yemenis and Afghanis? European and American nations, Western nations. And so you look at even foreign policy, and this is another area where our interests are not being followed. And beyond, you know, again, we can take it piece by piece by piece, and if we can wrap it up all in a pretty nice package. We look at the situation in Europe, which I think is very telling about what we should do in America, where you see that for 20 or 30 years, they've been bringing in immigrants from North Africa and the Middle East. And every month, every week, we see what that has wrought. We see it in the London Bridge attacks. We see it in the St. Petersburg metro bombing. We saw it in the metro bombing this week in Parsons Green. There was a chemical attack in the mall in England. I think it was just yesterday. Six people injured. Or was six people dead? I'm not totally sure on that example. But we see what immigration has wrought in Europe, and yet the policy continues. The policy continues by the federal government, by the federal governments in Europe, the central governments rather. And what happens after the terror? What happens after the civil unrest that is unleashed by this friction that you have when you have a clash of civilizations on your doorstep? You see the expansion of the surveillance state. You see every time that they introduced another 1,000 soldiers to patrol the streets of Europe. And I cannot countenance, I do not believe, that every time there is a terror attack and nobody is stopped from coming into these countries, instead, you have an expansion of government. Every time you have an expansion of the authority of the same people that are bringing all this friction and this unrest to our doorstep. It's not a coincidence. We have to stop calling it a coincidence. You look at a city like Chicago, where I'm from, and the demographics of the city, it's 33% Mexican, it's 33% black, and it's 33% white. And if you sit in on their city council meetings, it does not look like the United States of America. It looks a lot more like Brazil, or China, or Indonesia, or some banana republic. Because when you have no community, when you have no nation in the real sense of the term, you cannot have representation, you cannot have a country. And so I think that's the future of America. That is what is called for America. I don't know where it comes from in the highest corridors of powers among the rootless transnational elites, but what they are trying to introduce is a country where there is no community, there is no connection to your forefathers, to your race, to your ethnicity, to your country, but only to the individual consumer, the individual consumption unit. They think it better that you sit at home eating your Doritos, drinking your Miller Lite, watching the big game, you know, with your bros playing Xbox Live, than having a strong family with 10 children and loving them all and being a part of the community. And so I'll close with a story, and this will show you how bad it is. Sure. Well, you know, we'll have the Q&A, but it's a pretty long story, so maybe it's not a close, but. So I was at the Leadership Institute earlier in the summer. Yeah, I've told people the story before. But so I'm at the Leadership Institute in late July. And so I was there. I don't know if you guys are familiar, but this is what they call a do tank. It's all very gimmicky. They're not a think tank, you see. They're a do tank. They're men of action. And so this is an organization that has just no shortage of money. They don't know what to do with all the millions of Koch brother and other donor money that they have. And they have an incredible reach across the country on college campuses. We're talking thousands and thousands of students that are getting educational materials, that are getting connections to people in politics. And that just gives you, I think that just is to say the scope and the scale of this organization and what this says about the youth and the infrastructure today, that this happened in the belly of that beast. And so you look at the scale of this organization, and I went there in late July for a job training to be a field representative. And every year they have, or every semester rather, they have about 20 or 30 kids, and they spread out to every state in the country, Wisconsin, Iowa, you know, they have different regional groups. And they send these kids, they pay them $14,000 for 3 months of work to open up Young Americans for Liberty chapters, Turning Point USA chapters. So when people talk about this conservative awakening among the youth, that's what they're talking about, the Leadership Institute, where they're sending out these kids to start up these libertarian, socially liberal, fiscally conservative organizations. And so I went there for that job training, and I was there, and the first day we had an instructor, and I have never met her before. I didn't really know how much of my power level I could reveal. I didn't know if they were cool yet, I guess, so to speak. And so I showed up there, and we were just doing something as preliminary as introductions. And they wanted us to go around and say your name, how old you were, what school you were from, and why you were there. Why you were there to advance conservatism, a right-wing ideology. And they go around the room, and all your 18 and 9-year-olds are talking about, oh, we want to cut taxes. We want more wars in the Middle East. We want, you know, we want more George W. Bush. We want a fourth term for George W. Bush. And finally, it got to me, and I said, well, you know what? I look around the Western world today. I look at the United States of America. I look at the migrant crisis in Europe. I look at my ancestral homeland. I'm also 50% Italian. I look at Italy. And Italy is not Italy anymore. Paris is no longer Paris. France is no longer France. I said, and you can talk about tax policy, you can talk about healthcare policy all day long, but if you don't get the demographics right, if we don't save our people, nothing else matters. And I'm here to save my people, which... Now, admittedly, it was a little... more extreme than I intended for that crowd. You know, I should have probably just kept my mouth shut on the immigration stuff because that's the omerta that they enforce in the DC establishment. Well, I mean, you'll never believe the consequence. So I go through, and it's a grueling 2-week training. They tell us they have dorms. They tell us, you know, don't worry about living accommodations. For this 2-week training, we have dorms for you. There were not dorms. It was a bunker, okay? It was a military-style bunker. It's 25 people in a room on bunk beds, no cell reception. So I go through this living hell for 2 weeks with all these other normies talking about, you know, tax policy. And I find out at the end of it, after all this, after like 12 hours of lectures a day for 2 weeks, that I don't get the job. And I say, you know, why not? Not for nothing, but you look at some of the people they hire, people that wear graphic t-shirts untucked, people that are 30 years old and can't afford their car payments. They're not sending their best, you know, let's put it that way. And so they tell me, you know, you don't get the job, we don't think you're material for this, and I'm sort of dumbstruck. More than anything else, I'm wondering, well, you know, why didn't I get the job? I have experience campaigning for Donald Trump, for Ted Cruz, for Paul Neal, and for many candidates. I've done work, I've organized all sorts of organizations on college campuses. You know, why didn't I get it? And I found out through a little birdie that on the first day of the 2-week training exercise, when I made my little introduction, I made my sensational introduction, that the person that ran that seminar, the person that was the instructor for that day, was an immigrant from Lebanon. And when she heard that I wanted to protect my people, to save my people, she said that was racist. And so she went in the back rooms and she torpedoed my application, and she said that I'm a white supremacist, a white nationalist, and they couldn't take a risk to hire me. And I think that illustrates fundamentally this question of assimilation, where you have someone who, by all appearances, speaks English fluently since she was a child. You know, she's a Western college graduate, a cosmopolitan, as Stephen Miller might say. We would say that that person who listens to Kanye West, isn't that so edgy? Someone who watches Disney Channel, we might say that that person is assimilated. But when it comes to the question of putting America first, she is still an immigrant. She still thinks like someone outside of the country. And to wrap it all up, to put a little bit of an olive branch out there for people that might think I'm a little bit out there, I would say this. Whether or not you think immigration should be cut in half with the RAISE Act, whether or not you think it's illegal immigration or legal immigration, no matter what your argument is, when the 1965 Immigration Act was passed, and it fundamentally changed the demographics of this country forever and the composition of the immigration coming here, We were told explicitly by Ted Kennedy that that would not be the case. We were told that our country would not change. And whether or not you agree with what's happening, whether you're for the immigration, the invasion, or not, we were never given a choice. We were never given a vote. For 50 years, they did not ask us. They have told us that this is what's going to happen to our country, our states, our communities, the schools, where our children go. And if they believe in democracy so much, and that is the sacred religion of this country now, I would say they should put their money where their mouth is. Thank you. Thank you.
That's pretty good. I think you're the first guy that's got a standing ovation.
Wow.
You can call and you got another 15 minutes to take questions.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much. So we'll go for questions now. Sure, you. Everybody asked me that question about Generation Z versus Millennials. And so far as I can see, it is true. Because Generation Z, I was born in 98. People are usually triggered by this if they're a little older. You know, they imagine what they were doing in 98 and I was born. And I was born in 1998. And so for my entire life, the narrative by the mainstream media, Hollywood, pop culture has been, you're white, shut up. You're white, you're evil, you're a bigot, you have no culture, you can't dance, you're lame, you know, that sort of thing. And so I think Generation Z, with all this identity politics, that's sort of a buzzword, but it is true. As politics have been saturated with this tribalism, which has been predicted by Kaplan and Huntington before, as it's been saturated, I think white Generation Z people are especially receptive to this message. So I think there's definitely a difference, absolutely. Yeah. Well, that's a big part of it. That's even like my parents. I'm trying to get my mom to read Notes from the Underground, and I'm trying to get my dad to read, like, Culture of Critique and, you know, these other books, and they just can't pull themselves away from the television for long enough. But having said all that, I don't blame them. They go to work from 9 to 5, so it's like, if you want to chill out after work, you know, I can understand you're not ready for a full-on, you know, philosophical pogrom or, you know, whatever. But so, anyway, the distraction, that's definitely a good point. I think that's something that's crucial with young people, and it's really an existential thing where actually I think they would be receptive to our message, because young people, if you look at the drug abuse epidemic, if you look at the suicide epidemic affecting our young people, we were told by Francis Fukuyama, we were told like 20 or 30 years ago, but that the answer was material wealth, that, you know, once we made a lot of money, once we had a big salary, we had all the material goods, we would be okay. And now you see that young people are saying, no, that's necessary, but maybe not sufficient to live a fulfilled life. So, and particularly among my peers, certainly I've seen the drug epidemic, the suicide epidemic in very personal ways. And I think to appeal to young people with this concept of nation, this concept of a country, something larger that they can focus on, I think they'd be particularly receptive. And most people might not believe this, but people, you know, they have this addiction to the distractions, the social media, the music, the television, sort of like Brave New World stuff. But at the same time, they're looking for something to step outside of that. That's why you have all these like vegan trends. People are looking for that something else to give to their life to. And I think this could be that for them. Sure. That's a great question, because I see so often with the nationalist movement, you have, they're reading all the right material, you know, they're talking to all the right people, but there are no identifiable objectives. There's no goals. We don't know how to get to where we're going. And so this is something I've actually thought about a lot, because people ask me all the time, you know, that's all fine and well, you've described the problem, but what's your prescription? And so I've put together sort of this platform on my show, America First, for how we can get us going in the right direction, and the answer is the family. The answer is we have to restore strong families, strong fathers, strong mothers. And the practical way to do this is to rethink economic policy. I know people in like the nationalist right, they get a little triggered when you talk about economics, because it's like, oh, you know, you care about the GDP over your own family, but you need to make a society that is conducive to having families again. Why are middle-class people not having kids? People say it's, well, when you get higher income, people just stop having kids. But you look at the Kennedys, you look at the Trumps, and that's not necessarily the case. That's a little bit of correlation causation. What you have is a country where the average price of a home is $188,000. The average cost of a child from the time they're born until they're 18 is $250,000. You look at the rising cost of food, of fuel, of houses, of education, and wages are going down and not up, and interest rates have been near zero for 10 years. And even if people wanted kids, even if the mainstream media weren't actively encouraging people to not have kids for population, you know, stuff, whatever, people wouldn't be able to do it. And certainly I'm in a position where I'm not able to do it, unfortunately. So we would have to, then there's a two-part solution. Number one, recreate an economic system where it's conducive to having families. And Marco Rubio, I wasn't a fan, but he did propose a tax policy where you had, I think, a $2,500 tax credit for having a child. If we subsidized families, if we subsidized home ownership, we incentivized savings with the Federal Reserve monetary policy that made sense, that was geared towards not spending, not profligate spending, but saving and investing, I think by 2050, this problem would rebound. And this demographic winter that people are talking about would become our strength. So that's the economic side. The social side is we need apolitical social movements, people that are encouraging physical fitness, people that are encouraging religion. I mean, that's something that's lost, but that is the bedrock of everything. People that are encouraging classical education, reading books in their native languages, primary sources, things of that nature, classical music. If we get the apolitical social movement, which does not have to be like offensive or bigoted or edgy or anything like that, but just appeals to something intuitive, instinctual that people have been missing, and at the same time make it possible. If we lay that foundation by 2050, I think you'll see a rebound. So that's my proposal. Thank you.